therefore,
and therefore it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but also for us. It shall be imputed to us who believe in him, who raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead.
Amen. Somebody has Romans chapter number 4, verse 6. Amen. Hebrews chapter number 10, verse 14, someone. Them that are sanctified. Thank you. Romans chapter 5, verse 17. Anyone there? Amen. So today we want to look at the subject of what happens when a Christian sins. And you know that Christians do sin. Amen. We all have proof to that effect. The Bible tells us in the book of 1 John chapter number 1 verse 8 to 9, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. As Christians, we will eventually, note that word, we will eventually stumble, and we will eventually sin. We may tone it down and said, every now and then we may sin. So that happens. So that's why the provision has been made. Every time we miss the mark. Another word for iniquity or for sin or for being unjust is to miss the mark. Another word is disobedience. So that happens. What makes us different from what we were before conversion is that we now have a new nature. And I remember in our study last week when we were talking about identity, who we are in Christ Jesus, I reiterated over and over again that as believers, we do not have a nature of sin. We have the nature of God. So we have a new nature. So when sin comes in, when we take a wrong step, when we do something that God is not happy about, that nature does not change. It grieves us to sin. We don't want to sin. We want to live a righteous life. Now, that is the status quo for a believer. A believer is not happy at sinning. But every once in a while, we stumble and we fall. We don't sin willingly. We sin by error. We don't just plan it out to do anything that God is not happy about. But every once in a while, because we still have this thing called the flesh, we will fail to measure up to the standard of heaven. And whether it's a big sin or small sin, little sin or mega sin, sin is sin. Any sin has the tendency to bring a short circuit into your relationship with God. Any sin, no matter how small we tend to make it to be, have a tendency to cut the flow between you and heaven. The first question that I want to ask you this evening, I wanted to grab the mic if you want to answer, is living a sinless life possible? Is it possible as a believer to live a sinless life? That's a question for everyone. Yes, someone is.
No, that's impossible because we go back to the scripture that said, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. The only one who ever lived a sinless life on this earth was Jesus. And it's too hard for us as human beings to live a life without sinning, because every day we sin somehow in thoughts, in words, in deeds. So it's impossible for a believer or anyone, any human being, to live a sinless life.
That's a very good answer. Anyone else? You're very much welcome, Sonia. God bless you.
I think it's a very dangerous position to go, that a believer cannot but live a sinless life, a sinful life. The point is, like Pastor says, it's about nature. If it's impossible to live a holy life, God won't say, be holy as I'm holy. At the same time, God doesn't want to put us under a form of burden to say that, so that when we may sin or we do sin, we are going to come like, I'm condemned, God does not approve of me anymore. I think the place where it's possible, and I think the goal is gradually, the longer we live as believers, the more is as we build into the image of God, we should be transformed day in, day out. You know, we should be closer to perfection. Even though, at every point in time I may sin, but it's not the license to say, well, it's impossible to live a sinless life, and I'm just gonna go ahead with whatever comes my way.
Beautiful. The question is it possible? So Sister Carol went to it is hard. The question is not whether it's hard. Is it possible? Beautiful. Let's go on. Beautiful discussion tonight.
I'll try it tomorrow.
You what?
I'll try it tomorrow.
Well, I think it's possible. It's very, very possible for a Christian to sin, because to never sin, rather.
Okay.
Because even if it's not possible, it won't be in the template of prayer that God gave us, which is the Lord's Prayer, and that particular clause where God says, "Forgive us our trespasses, as we have forgiven those who have trespassed against us." And also is an instruction that it says, if one offends you, you have to forgive the person over and over and over again. So that clause actually is saying that for every time we sin, we should also pray for our own forgiveness.
Okay, so you're contradicting yourself now. No. Yeah, so is it possible,
it's possible
to live a sinless life, or it is not possible to live a sinless life? Yes, it's mommy. Let's go. Beautiful. So we look into the script. What I should have told you is when you're going to bring out your perspective, you follow it up with the scriptures.
To me, it's not possible to live a sinless life. Even though you have the will to try as much as possible not to offend any of your neighbors or your siblings, still, in one way or the other, maybe by action, by talking, they may say, oh, the way you talk is somehow that you have offended them. Then to you, you will look at yourself that in which way? That's a sin. Even sometimes when you are praying, asking God to forgive you your sins, you have said that before, along the way, on your along your praying line, something will come up from your heart that, oh, somebody did so things to me. So that matter that the neighbor or anybody has, the way they have offended you, even though you have the mind of forgiving and for forgetting about it, that human action will bring it out from inside you. So instead of continuing with your prayers, you will start nursing that action.
Alrighty. Let's the beautiful discussion tonight.
I was just having this conversation with one of my flatmates this morning, and they were telling me something, and they were like, I said, that's a lie. It wasn't nothing serious. And they were like, no, it's not. It's just it's a white lie. Have you heard of it? And I was like, true story. I said, I'm calling Pastor. Pastor said there's no white lies. And the truth is, and then we were going back and forth. We were joking about it. We were going back and forth. He's like, but it's, and we Googled it, a white lie. And it says, true story. And we said, it says to not to really truly offend someone. So you lie just to, it's a lie not to really hurt someone's feelings. It's a sin. It's a lie. So even at the end of the day, even if it's a case of you're trying to do it to help someone or you're trying to anything like that. So point of the story is I think that it's impossible to not sin. Even when you're in someone's best interest or your own best interest, it's impossible.
All right, I'm looking at the time. Number one, let's break it down. What does sin mean? Disobedience to God. When you look at the scriptures, Genesis to Revelation, that is the basic, simple definition. People can talk about other things, missing the mark, but pretty much sin is disobedient against God. So is it possible to live a life of total obedience to God? Is it possible to live a life of complete obedience to God? Yes, it is. It is possible. Don't get me wrong, it is hard. It is difficult. As long as we are in this flesh. But possibility, yes. There was someone that the Bible talked about, Enoch, that there was no account of unrighteousness with him. He walked with God. And God decided to take him. Maybe because my own interpretation, not yours. Maybe God thought, tomorrow this guy is going to, you know. And there were people like that in the scriptures. Even the person called Joseph. Yeah? What about Job? The account of Job as well. There was no record of, you see, the scriptures is a clear book written about humans. So he did not hide any of their imperfection. Who? But that was holy anger. But I mean, one of the best examples we have in the scriptures is the man Enoch and the man Joseph. That there was no record of wrongdoing. And of course, the best example of all is Jesus Christ, who lived in the same flesh like we did. And by the virtue of the fact that he has the Spirit of God, he was sinless throughout. So what I'm saying in essence is all these people, very few people in the scriptures, that there was no record of any wrongdoing. If they had done something wrong, that is my perspective, the Bible would have been explicit about it. I mean, Noah, it would have been easy to hide his imperfection, but Noah planted a vineyard, he gone drunk, and you know the story more than I do, and many other people in the scripture. So, to live a life of complete obedience, a believer walking on the face of the earth without sin or iniquity, possible. As a matter of fact, that is what the Holy Spirit has come to do in us. But let me be very honest with you. As long as we are in this flesh, it's always a tough call. As a matter of fact, for someone who wants to live in complete obedience, by the time you get to a stage in your life and you want to show to the world that you are living in complete obedience, that in itself is sin. So it's a tough call to make. And when you read books like Sanders, right? What's his name? Oswald Sanders. You see some of these devotionals just talking about that. You consciously walk in a way that you are not too far off there to show your... Because by the time you get to a place where you are showing your righteousness, that in itself is a sin. So, to live a sinless life, it is possible. That's why the scripture is written. For our example, so that we sin not. As a matter of fact, the Bible uses the phrase, anyone that commits sin is of the devil. And it's talking about anyone that willingly lives in unrighteousness. But I'm going to be very honest with you. It's a tough call. It's difficult. And even in when we look, I gave you some human examples in the Bible. And your argument may be right that maybe there are some things they did and nobody picked it. But the perfect example that we have is Jesus. And that is why throughout the scriptures, the admonition is for us to be like Jesus. And if he knows that we cannot be like him, he wouldn't have told us to be like him. The Bible wouldn't have said in the book of Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 that we should be keep on looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. So we can argue it back and forth, and this is not up for an intellectual debate. This is just a pure spiritual truth. That the only reason why we can aim at righteousness and living in complete obedience is because it is possible for us to do so. But based on where we are in our journey right now, some people may not even see the possibility of that, and that's fine. That's called growth. But as we look into the scriptures, this perfect law of liberty, this word of God, that is written to inspire us, to challenge us, to make us become better, we see that the Bible used the word, we are transformed into a better shape. There are some things, for example, when I gave my life to Christ, I never believed that it is possible that bad thoughts wouldn't cross your mind every moment. I never believed it. I just thought, I was young when I gave my life to Christ. I just thought, that's how can you not have bad thoughts? And growing in Christ, I know it is possible. As a matter of fact, it's possible for the thought to flash and for you to let it go. You know? So the Holy Spirit is the seal that we have to live a life that is pleasing to God. The more subject we are to Him, the more of Christ we are. But I'm going to let you know, I've said it over and over again, I'll say it again, the flesh is not going to find it easy. It's not going to be easy. But I'm not asking whether it is hard or easy, I'm asking whether it is possible. So what happens when we do sin? Do we need to get born again? Do we need to get saved again? Is that what the Bible is teaching? In that case, we have no security. And in some sense, we are worse off than the world. At least the world is not tormented by a sin conscience. I wanted to underline this: as believers, sin is not to be our focus of attention. That's not supposed to be our focus of attention. So we don't wake up every day and we go, okay, have I sinned today? What did I do today? What is, you know, very, very exhausting, you know? So sin is not going to be our attention. God is supposed to be our focus and attention. So that's, we must get that right. But when Hebrews chapter 10 verse 2 says it, you know, that through the sacrifice of Jesus, the believer should have no more conscience of sins. The word that is used for conscience of sins is actually the word consciousness of sin. So we don't come to church sitting and asking the person, okay, how many sins did you commit today? So that I will compare mine to you with yours, so that I will know who is more qualified to lead a praise and worship or who is more qualified to serve. We don't have that consciousness. We have God consciousness. Very, very important. Very, very important. In other words, sin should never be the focus of our lives. Underline this, God should be our focus. We must just start each and every day excited that we're going to please Him. And when we refuse to, we confess to Him, we move on, we start the next day with the assurance, with the confidence that we are still going to please Him. Very important. We don't start believing that, oh, today we're just going to commit sin and be miserable and all of that. And as a matter of fact, the scripture is true. If God takes record of iniquity, there's no one that can stand. If He has the book where He checks every moment what you did so wrongly, you're not going to have any right standing before Him. Romans chapter 4 verse 2 says, for if Abraham were justified, the word justified, we will never really appreciate the full extent of it until we see the face of Jesus, to be declared righteous. Some people make it a subject of debate, but it's beyond debate. Just as someone that has been condemned, that was just declared righteous, not on his own account, but based on what Jesus has done and what He did over 2,000 years ago. He said, if Abraham were justified in the Old Testament by works, he had something to glory, but not before God. If salvation was based on our merit, the things that we do, then we could brag. We could say, hey, Lord, I really appreciate what you did on the cross, but remember what I have done too. So throughout eternity, we are going to pat Jesus on the back and pat ourselves on the back for the things that we've done. No. God, I want you to underline this, God has designed salvation in such a way that there will be no boasting or glory on man's part. Underline that. And what you have right there is simply the explanation of redemption. Redemption. He just gave you a substitute. Nothing. Let me just make this clear to us. I know when we started this series in January, I've said it many times, and I'm going to say it again. There is nothing you can do in the flesh as a human being by your power to win God's favor. You don't have what it takes to do that. Don't get me wrong, you are not that bad. At least not as bad as I am. Just kidding. But there is really nothing you can do in the flesh to win his approval, to make you righteous. Why? Because the kind of righteousness God expects of you, God expects you to have his own righteousness. And that is way too high. So there is really nothing you can do to attain that. So what happens? Knowing that you cannot attain that, he gave it to you based on what Jesus has done. And that is why we cannot boast. We cannot boast. The only glory and boasting will be in the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 3, verse 27. The gift of eternal life is indeed a gift. It cannot be earned. That is where we see in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, where it talks about the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Romans chapter 4, verse 2 says that if Abraham were justified by his own actions, he will have some reason to boast. But that was not what happened. How does the scripture say a man is saved? By his performance? By his own works? By coming to church? By doing good? Is that how a man is saved? How was Abraham counted righteous? Or how was he declared righteous? Was it by the things that he did? Or was it that he just believed? And that is why some people think that being a Christian is so hard, because the simplicity of it beats everybody's imagination. Just believe. How do you just explain to someone, just believe and your sins are forgiven? And you are declared just. Just believe. And for many people, the only hindrance, the only thing that is stopping them from coming to Christ, it is simplicity of salvation. Just to believe. Just to believe. God is going to help us in Jesus' name. So I wanted to look at these, that Abraham believed God. And when he believed God, it was counted to him for righteousness. I think one version of the Bible says righteousness was deposited into his account when he believed. He just believed God, and God said, righteousness. And so we got to understand that. And the reason why the church should talk a lot more about righteousness is whatever you talk about in church is what people are conscious of. A church that talks so much about witches and wizards, the people will see the power of darkness in everything. A church that talks so much about money and fame and wealth, the people will just run after that, even at the expense of their relationship with God. I mean, that's how the church is. Whatever we talk about more, we encourage people to thirst and hunger after that. So when people hear more about righteousness, they believe that, yes, they are righteous in Christ Jesus. And they can live a consistent, righteous life in Christ Jesus. And at the end of the day, nothing else will matter but to please God. You see, the whole duty, the number one assignment that we have as believers on the face of the earth is to live our lives in such a way that God is pleased. If you believe that, can you please say a big amen to that? That God is pleased. When God is pleased with you, every other thing is noise in the marketplace. When God is pleased, every other opinion is nothing but that, an opinion. Every other thing is nothing but a suggestion. When God is pleased with you, and everyone in the Old Testament, they strived for that balance, just to gain God's acceptance. But you know that in the New Covenant, we had it on a platter of gold. Jesus just laid down his life, and God said, I'm not angry anymore. When you come to me through the perfect sacrifice of my Son, you are accepted into the Beloved. So he expects us to believe, and when we believe, we are declared righteous. Say after me, when I believe, I'm declared righteous. Can you say it one more time? When I believe, I'm declared righteous. Okay, let's say it now in a way that it will make me mean it to us. When I believe, I'm declared sinless. Can we say one more time? When I believe, I'm declared sinless. Can you say one more time? When I believe, I'm declared sinless. Some people, somebody is like committing sin, even saying that. But that is the truth. God doesn't see us through the spectrum of sin anymore. He sees us through the sacrifice of his son. The ultimate sacrifice. The final sacrifice. The perfect sacrifice. You see, do you understand that the work of redemption cannot be improved upon? It's perfected in the death of Christ. It's finalized, finished in the death of the cross. Amen. What holds me in position and keeps me from perishing, even if though there are times when I fail and sin, is that Jesus bore all of my sin on the cross. And through faith in him, not by my own works, I am justified. Can you say after me, I am justified? Can you say after me, I am justified? And what does that mean? It's put there in bracket. What does it say? You are made righteous by God. Listen, if I make you righteous, I can only make you righteous up unto the standard of my righteousness. I can only declare you righteous based on, amen, in Jesus. So if making you righteous was the work of your pastor, you get as righteous as his own understanding of righteousness. But your righteousness is based on heaven's, Jesus' work of redemption. And that is why it cannot be improved upon. And I know we've touched on the subject of righteousness a couple of times during this study. By God and God alone. So there are some times people know you and they're like, hey, you righteous? I have some. But heaven declares you righteous. And that overrides every other conviction under the heaven. Romans chapter 4 verse 6 says, even as David also describes the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputes righteousness without works. You see, you're going to see some kind of juxtaposing here. You see how God does not impute sin, and he decided to impute righteousness. You know, the easiest word to understand impute is to put something on, and as soon as you put it on, it sticks on you, like it's part of you. That's the easiest way to understand impute. You have it on, everybody sees when you are putting it on, but as soon as you have it on, it just sticks close to you, and you can't take it off anymore. So that's what God does. He takes righteousness and puts his righteousness on you. And then that sticks to you. Let's look at that together. David of the Old Testament is saying that there will be a day through the new covenant when God will impute righteousness, right standing without man working for it. So everybody in the Old Testament, they were looking at the possibility of that. And that happened when Jesus gave his life for our sake. Then he said in verse 7, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are what? Covered. This is the clincher. Blessed is the man, Romans chapter 4 verse 7, to whom the Lord will not impute what? Sin. Did you see that? The Lord will not impute sin, though every once in a while we fall, every once in a while we do things that God is not proud of, but God will not impute sin. God will not see us through the nature of sin. He will see us through his own nature, the nature of righteousness. Do you know something? Do you know something that even if your son goes in the mud and plays with a pig and comes out, for a father that understands covenant relationship, he's still your son. He may look like a pig and sound like a pig and dress like a pig, still your son. Amen. it sounds like a dog and, walks like a dog and look like a dog, Aflac. But even if your son goes into the mud and plays with a pig in the mud, still your son. You don't see him through what? Through the spectrum of the mud. You see him through the spectrum of the covenant relationship that you have. The blood that flows in you and in him. So guess what? Let me make it easier for you. And when people truly understand this, they are liberated from living a life of sin. That there is really nothing that you will do that God will see you as an outcast unless you yourself decide to take yourself out as an outcast. When people understand this, it gives them liberty to live in righteousness. When people don't understand it, they see it as a liberty to live in sin. But when you understand that God loves you so much that at any point in time, He wants an unbroken relationship with you, you are just up on your toes every moment to have that unbroken relationship with your Father. It doesn't say He might not. Sometimes He will and sometimes He won't. It says, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. In the Greek, that's what is called emphatic negative. It means God will never not put sin into your account. This is the good news of the new covenant. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 16 says, I will put my laws into your heart, on their heart and in their minds, upon their mind also I will write them. And part of the agreement is that God says in verse 17, in your sins and iniquities I will remember no more. Can you please underline that? What holds you in position in righteousness and right standing, even when you sin and don't have time to confess it? This is it. Your faith in Jesus Christ. His name is Jesus and He saves His people from their sins. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21. Now, so you got to understand this. When you do anything that God is not pleased with, you ask for forgiveness. That's the biblical standard. Oh, people might have different perspectives. There may be all this revelation and all of that. But the Bible expects that when you, as a believer, when you do something that heaven is not happy about, you come to God and in sincere obedience, just like He taught us to pray, you know, just forgive me. I don't like the way I thought, the way I looked, the way I handled that, the way I yelled and screamed and hated and lied and stole. I just ask you, and say it in sincere language. Don't come with all those languages that you yourself don't even understand. And you know what? The moment you confess, it's like you have never done it before. It's like you have never committed that sin before. So the question is, what happens when a believer sins? What happens when a Christian does something that God is not happy about? Number one, you got to understand that the fact that a believer sins does not change the nature of righteousness that the believer has. People don't understand that. So the fact that you made a mistake does not change your identity as someone that is in union and communion with God. Amen? Amen. Is anyone with me here tonight? So the fact that you sin doesn't change who you are. You are still a child of God. You are only a child of God that fell into iniquity. So what happens when a believer sins? There is a possibility of broken relationship. Are you with me? The truth is, when you are a believer and you do something that God doesn't like, it hurts God, it hurts you. You don't go like, you know, some believers are so funny, they go just go like, oh, everyone does it. Oh, what a big deal. Oh, what's the point? Oh, it doesn't really matter. Have you ever heard things like that? It doesn't really matter. So the whole world does it. Oh, you don't understand. Some believers will go like, when you grow up, you will know. I don't want my reason for growing up to be like I'm growing up for one day to be living a sinful life without any remorse. Amen. So there is a possibility of a broken relationship. And when people use the word living in disobedience, is when a believer commits sin and does not come to the humility of admitting they are wrong. And they are not ready. They are not ready to go back and ask God for forgiveness. So there are sometimes we sin and we still cover it up. Just like the scripture says that anyone that covers their sin will not prosper. And when the word uses the word prosper, it means they will not prosper in covering it. So one day it's still going to be exposed. They will not prosper in that fact. But when anyone willingly confesses and forsakes them, the Bible says, they will receive justification, they will be pardoned. So you got to understand that sin does not change the nature. What sin does is just it causes broken fellowship. Okay? And the attitude of a believer when a Christian commits sin, the attitude of a Christian is to come back into fellowship. You don't go like, okay, it's not really, you know, some of the time you just look at your own sin and you go like, oh, my own sin is not as bad as IBK. I'm better. Just come to church and we compare ourselves with other people. Oh, you, Sister Carol, I'm way better off. And God doesn't look at us comparing us with ourselves. He looks at the finished work of Christ. The work of redemption. The work of redemption that is done once and for all. Amen. Anyone enjoying this tonight? Amen. So I want your thoughts. I want your questions before we quickly go and handle the questions and we go tonight. Anybody? Quick thoughts, quick word, quick question before we go tonight. Anybody? All right, sir.
I just want to, I know this is in the Old Testament, actually. But the Bible says everything that was written for us so that we may learn from it. Many times, when I consider this topic, I look at the example of David. Mm. After David had committed adultery and he had killed Uriah, committed murder. You know, when he was writing that psalm, he says, cast me not away from your presence, O God, and take not your Holy Spirit, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. So for me, that confirms what you were saying about the fellowship. Because the joy of his salvation was missing. Did not mean his salvation itself was missing, but he lost his joy.
Mm.
So again, when he was saying, do not take your Holy Spirit away from me. After what is done, if your Holy Spirit lives that way, if the nature was gone, if it was no longer God's son, it won't be the one telling God not to take his Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit would have left because he had done those things already. So we have to understand that the nature of a believer, we are redeemed by God. God has saved us. You know, earlier in the day, I was thinking about Demas. And he was somebody that worked with Paul, that co-labored with Paul. But at some point, Paul said he loved the things of this world.
Mm.
You know, he decided that he loved the things of this world more. It wasn't that God let him go. So many times we have to understand that God loves us unconditionally, but we just have to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. But there's nothing we can do to make God love us more. There's nothing we can also not do that will make God love us less. So we should, because I look at it this way. Someone that is born into the royal family, they don't have to do anything. They just grow up without understanding of royalty. Mm. So it takes away that unnecessary burden on them to maybe, what can I do to become royalty? So believers, we also have to start living with that understanding. We are royalty already. So it's not my act, as it were, that makes me royal. This is just my nature. This is who God has just redeemed me to be. And I will live. It takes away that burden of what can I do to measure up to God's standard.
Amen. This is one of those studies that you get more questions, but I'm loving it. Amen. Anyone else? Quick thoughts? It's been recorded, so you gotta use the mic. That's okay.
I just would like to comment something that I believe. For example, when Jesus Christ on the cross was punished because our sins, God that time put in Jesus our sins.
Mm.
To make sense, right?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Then when I commit any sin, when I fail, when I sin, I believe, that's my understand, God doesn't punish me anymore because Jesus already received all punishments.
Yeah.
Amen?
That's very much true.
Amen?
That's very much true. Anything that is the penalty of sin was put on Jesus, you know. But as a believer, when we sin, we ask him for the forgiveness, you know. But every punishment of sin was laid upon Jesus. That was why he died.
Because of that, we when we come before God and ask forgiving, we should not feel guilty anymore.
Amen. Amen.
You know, I used to be a Christian that long time ago that I was guilty for anything that I did wrong in the past. But recently God has given me messages like that. Jesus already got the punishment. I should not feel guilty anymore.
Amen.
As soon as I confess my sin.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. That's very much true. You see, what limits some believers is that guilt trap. And you see people who did something 20, 30 years ago, and they are still trying to remind God of what even angels cannot find the account. And they're just trying hard. So we cannot. Something about the nature of God, just like my brother was saying, it frees us. Whether we like it, some believers are caught off in performance agenda. We just want to perform. We are so much, we want to act like a prince. But if you are a prince, you don't have to act like one. You know? It doesn't matter if you are wearing shirts or your hair is tattered or you are wearing rags. As a matter of fact, when you wear rags, people think it's a kingly style because you are a prince. You know? So, some of the time, believers are caught so much in the performance. I want to act holy. I want to pretend to be righteous. And unfortunately, that's what brought about some movement that we cannot trace to the scriptures. And that was what Paul was saying. Then you begin to put the bondage on people, the bondage that you yourself cannot bear, just to make them to try to please God. And that was what Jesus did. For our sake. So we should always come into his presence with the understanding that God is not angry. You know, some preachers pretend God like this angry dude, always angry, always waiting for when you're going to go wrong and then wham, catches you. That's not God. I'm sorry. They lied to you. That's not God. They make God look so angry, so vicious, so he just want to make sure he punishes you for something that you have done even before you were born. That's not God of the scriptures. God of the scriptures was the one that decided to put everything on his son so that you and I can come freely without fault, uncondemned. Uncondemned. Anytime the spirit of condemnation comes upon you, it cannot be from God. It's from the enemy. It's from the devil. But some believers pretend like that is what is next to holiness. Oh, I'm just condemned. Oh, I can't even. No. Let's try and do some questions before we go tonight. When you look at Romans chapter 4, verse 5, we read it earlier on. God makes righteous people who are what? Ungodly. So write it down there, please. That's number one. Those of us here now who are ungodly, those who are not here, God made us all righteous. Romans chapter 4, verse 2 to 3. God put something in Abraham's account when he believed. What was it? Righteousness. Righteousness. And all of us have accounts. And that account is always in green. Because we have righteousness always deposited there. If we believe as Abraham did, what we got put to our account? Righteousness. And he already did. You see, righteousness is not something God will give us later. We have it now. We have it already. Amen. So people are always futuristic about righteousness. One day I'm going to be righteous. And some of the time we sing songs about it. One day I'm going to be holy. One day I'm going to be righteous. No, today you are. When you gave your life to Christ, you come to him based on the work of redemption, not on your works, not on your times, he gives it to you. Now, so let's look at this. When you look at Romans chapter 4, verse 6, even as David described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputes righteousness without works. Look at this. God puts righteousness to a person, A, according to their works, B, apart from their works, see according to how nice they are. What is the right answer? Apart from their works. So God doesn't look at your works. But don't get me wrong. Your works are good because people have to see your good works and glorify Jesus. But you have righteousness without, apart from your works. The only reason why you can do good works is because you're already righteous. That's the only reason why your good works are acceptable in the first place. Are you all loving it? Amen. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 14. For by one offering he hath made perfected forever them that are sanctified. How long are believers perfected before God? Perpetually, forever. Forever. So you don't feel righteous on Sunday and feel miserable on Monday. You are perpetually accepted before God. So the word is perpetually, forever. Amen. Number six, two more questions to go after this. When you look at Romans chapter 5 verse 17, for if by one man offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Righteousness is received, number one, by earning it. Number two, as a gift. Number three, by working for it. What is the right answer? As a gift. But you know something that that keeps re-echoing in my mind. A gift is not a gift to you until you receive it. Amen. It may be a gift from the giver, but until you receive it. So you receive it. You believe it. That even when you don't feel like it, you're still righteous before God. Amen. I believe some of the songs that we sing, we begin to sing them in line of understanding of the scriptures. We receive it as a gift. Number seven, what does the word gift imply? Anybody? The word gift, something that is freely given, something that you receive that at no expense of yours. That's a gift. Amen. Something that you just look at redemption and say, oh, redemption, I would need this. And then you bring it and you don't say, okay, I would need you to give me my credit card number so that we can. It's a gift. It's a gift. No account to you. Number eight. To trust Jesus to be your personal Savior, you must trust Him to take you all the way to, number one, this is a very quiet funny one, church, number two, heaven, number three, I don't know why Russia is there, can you imagine Russia? So you trust Him that as long as you live in this flesh, He's going to take you to heaven. Somebody shout a big amen to that. Play that song for me that says, bless the Lord, oh my soul, as we get ready for our offerings together tonight. May I please request that we all stand as we pray together. Hallelujah. Just hold someone's hands close to you as we pray. Just ask and say, Lord, thank you for your righteousness that you have imputed upon my life. Thank you for the nature of Christ that I have in me. Oh Lord, I just worship you. I just want to thank you for all that you have done. I want to thank you for all that you have. Can you just make it your prayer tonight? And as you walk out of here in that confidence, assurance, that what He has done is just more than enough. It is more than enough. Thank you, Father. We just worship you. We thank you for righting our wrongs. Thank you for giving unto us even the work of salvation that was perfected on the cross. Thank you for Jesus taking our place. You know, in a few days from now, we're going to be celebrating Easter, celebrating the season of the death and resurrection of Jesus. I just want you for a few seconds to just say, Lord, I want to thank you for what you did when you hung on that cross. I want to thank you for what you did when you hung on that cross. I want to thank you for what you did when you hung on that cross. Lord, I give you praise. I give you glory. Thank you for the work of salvation. To you be all of the glory forevermore. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Say after me, I'm the righteousness of God. In Christ Jesus, I've been redeemed. I've been delivered. I've been declared just. So I speak unto myself that I will live on each and every day basis as a godly, as a righteous, as a sinless, as a just, brother or sister, just put whatever, yeah, you know, whatever it is. Daughter or son, just put whatever it is. Perpetually. Until I see the face of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Lord, I give you praise. Just begin to rejoice in the fact that you are what he calls you to be. Not what the world says, not what denomination or religion says. Just rejoice in the fact of what, can you play Bless the Lord, O My Soul, in what he has called you to be. Lord, we just exalt your name. Thank you, Lord. We rejoice in the fact that we have been liberated, made sinless by the finished work of the cross. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Bless the Lord.
Amen. For a minute or two, please, let's sing together as you give your offerings tonight. Amen.
Worship his holy name.
Sing like never before.
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new
Thursday, we have a study. If you look at the church's calendar, Thursday, more feels into the day going into the Friday when Jesus was hung on the cross, before the Good Friday when he gave up his ghost. So we're going to have a service in this place just to celebrate what he has done. On Saturday, we're going to be giving out what we call Easter redemption packages. We are planning. I announced last week, I spoke about it on Sunday. We're planning to give out about 1,000 packages at the intersection of Steinway and Broadway. We want you to please come and join us on that Saturday. That's next week Saturday, not this Saturday. Good Friday at around 12 noon. If you can come around here, that would be great. At 12 noon, we're going to have a very brief Good Friday service, 12 noon and one hour. To sing some songs, and after that service for 1 hour, we're going to pack all the redemption packages. Okay, everything we're going to be giving out on the street on Saturday, we pack it together. But before then, we have a 1 hour Good Friday service at 12 noon. If you look at the scriptures, it's around that time that Jesus gave up the ghost, you know. So we have the service, we sing together, we worship, and we just rejoice, celebrate our victories, and then we pack the things for redemption. And the next day, which happens to be the 26th, is when we take them out to Steinway and Broadway to give out those packages. If you want to give to any of those projects, feel more than welcome to do that. We know it's going to be a wonderful time. And on Sunday, the 27th, we have an Easter Sunday, and the theme for our service on Sunday the 27th is the power of his resurrection.
So if you have anyone that is going through one affliction, addiction, fear, anything whatsoever, if you're listening to me right now and you're in New York City and you're just believing God for deliverance to set you free, you are trusting God for healing, we know that the power of resurrection is able to deliver. Everything you read in the scriptures is still possible today. So I encourage you to invite people, anyone that is just trusting God for a breakthrough in one area of their lives or another. Tell them about our Easter weekend services, and we just come here believing God for a mighty move of the power of the Holy Spirit in this place. Amen. I want to encourage you to join us on Sunday. This Sunday we continue the series we started, CWC, Counting What Counts. We started on relationships that count last Sunday, and this Sunday we're going to be looking at beyond conflicts. I'm so super excited about next Sunday service. And last Sunday I got a lot of great feedback of people that just enjoyed it so much. So please come on Sunday. Let's do it together. We are putting some of the audio clips of the messages. We are loading them online now so that people that have been requesting, a lot of people have been requesting for this. In the next 1 week or thereabout, we have quite a number of them, and we'll tell you where to go. There's going to be a strong link from the website where people can listen to some of these teachings and some of the messages over and over again. Amen. I just want to say thank you for coming around. It's been a wonderful time in the presence of the Lord tonight. Can you please lift up your hands as I pray from here? Father, we just want to thank you for all that you are. We are who we are today because of what you did over 2,000 years ago. We give you praise even this solemn time when we remember the ultimate sacrifice, when we remember your death, when we remember the fact that you laid down your life because of us. What a sacrifice. What a heart of love and generosity. Thank you, Father. Lord, as we go from here, let your mighty hand be upon us. We pray, O God, that you will cause your blessings to be upon us, and you will bless others through us. For as many as were not able to make it, even to tonight's meeting, we pray wherever they are that you will touch them, you will minister to them, you will meet them at the point of their needs. We ask, O God, even for our service on Sunday, that you cause your name to be glorified in our midst. Thank you, Father. I declare, may the Lord bless you, may the Lord keep you, may the Lord make his face to shine upon you, may the Lord cause the light of his countenance to be eternally bright upon you, may the Lord be gracious unto you, and may he give you peace this day and for the rest of your life. And remember, the Bible says, whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world, for this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. You are an overcomer. Go ahead and be all that God wants you to be. Have a beautiful night, everyone.